Hello and welcome to this tutorial on looking at and using and understanding the automation modes in Adobe Premiere Pro. Now the automation modes are all to do with sound, how we can raise and lower the level of sound automatically without having to go in and set keyframes in the timeline. Now at the moment I have two sound files in my project panel. I've got the advert final, which is just a WAV file, which is just spoken words. And then the music file, which I'm going to mix it with just for demonstration purposes. And I got this file from Sonic Fire Pro. Okay, so let's have a very quick listen to the files. Firstly, the advert, you select it in the project panel and you can play a preview up here in the project panel.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer, he expected to lose his hair. He even expected to lose some weight, but he never expected to lose his home.
Okay, so that's the sound for the spoken word. Now quick listen to the music, so select it and hit play. I wouldn't necessarily choose these two files for my final production, but for an example these are going to work just fine. So this is how you may have mixed audio before. You take your audio file, you drag it and drop it into layer 1 or audio 1 of your open sequence and let go. Now if you can't see the waveform, you can close it and open it like that. You can do that for any. Now we are just going to be looking at audio, so I don't need to see these video tracks. And the simplest way to move the waveform up is to go to the middle bar here in the header section. You can't do this in the main section. You can only do this in the header section. Click and drag it up. And then we can let go at the top there so that we can just see our audio waveform. And if we want to see a bigger view of our audio waveform, we can again click at the bottom of it and pull it down and let go, and then we've got a much bigger view of the audio waveform. So that's how you can see the audio waveform in Premiere Pro. Now if we wanted to change the levels, you'll notice that it says here, come on over freshbrew.wav, this is the name of the file, and here next to it it's got a little drop down, it says volume level. The only other option we have is bypass, so actually we're showing just the level. We're not going to bypass it, we're going to leave it the level. That means that this yellow bar in the middle here is actually the volume bar. And at the moment, if I hover over it, you can see that at the middle there, I've got a little icon with an up arrow and a down arrow and a line in the middle. And it says exactly where we are, so it's 7 seconds and 6 frames in, and it's saying 0.00 dB. The volume level is set at its default level. Now I can just click and drag and pull it up and raise the whole thing up, and if I hover over it now, it says it's at 2.2 dB, so it's louder, and I can click and I can drag, and you can see it's giving me some feedback in the window there saying it, that would be minus 2.7 dB, so that's gone quieter. Again, if I hover over it, you'll see the same thing, and I can click and drag and take it back to, actually I want it back at zero. So that would move the volume of the whole thing. But what we used to do previously is we had to add keyframes to raise and lower it at appropriate places. To do that, we had to create keyframes on this line. And to do it, you can do it a number of ways. So I can take my timeline to the right place, so it's just there. And then I can either click here to create a keyframe. So if I click a keyframe, I'll show you. Add and remove keyframe, click. Or alternatively, let me just move a little bit further, say where the end would be. So there. I can hold the control key on a PC, the command key on a Mac, and click, and that adds a keyframe. And then if I wanted keyframes in the middle, then I would go back a little, control or command click, and go back a bit further towards the first one, control and command click, and then this bit in the middle, I can click and drag and pull it down, and I've now got a fade, an audio fade. It's going to come along at the right level, down, across, and up, and I've done that by creating keyframes, but this is not a very effective way. But let me play for you so you can see what it sounds like. Okay, so we've created an audio fade. That's the old way, that's the keyframe way, but actually we want to do it much easier than this. We want to use the automation modes to do it effectively. So I'm going to do Control Z on the PC, Command Z on the Mac a few times just to get rid of these keyframes. And we're back to where we started. Now what we need to do to learn how to use the automation modes is to open up the audio mixer panel up here, linked with the effects controls and the source panel. So click on the audio mixer, And now we have audio channels for all of the tracks that we have. So we actually have a master track. Here's the master track down here. And then we have audio 1, audio 2, and audio 3. And here they are, audio 1, audio 2, audio 3. And I can select audio 1, and I can highlight it, and I can put it as my music. You hit return, and you'll see that up here it says music, and down here it says music, and we've renamed the track. So audio 2 is going to be spoken word. So if I highlight it up here, spoken word, hit return, it now says spoken. Well, you can't see all of it because the track header is not long enough. You can pull the track header out if you get to it properly. There we go, spoken word, so you can see the whole thing. These icons here are telling me that they are stereo tracks, and as you can see, there's two channels on each of these. These are stereo tracks. So this is my audio mixer panel, and if I want to bring in my spoken word to my spoken word channel, I can literally grab, drag, and drop it into the second channel. And if I open it up, I can actually get a feel for how the audio works, and I can pull it open and look at the waveform more clearly like that. Now, this audio is going to be too quick for me. I'm going to actually want to cut it up a little bit. Each of these sections are going to need to have a bit more of a space so I can raise music and learn music. So the first thing I'm going to want to do is actually get the pacing of my audio correct. To start off with, I want the music to play, and then I want the audio to start, and then I want to have a pace between the first section and the second section. Unfortunately, I can't actually hear what I'm doing because of my computer setup, so I'm just going to show you the general principles. If it doesn't sound fantastic, please forgive me, but the principles will be right. So I'm going to pull it along a bit so that we've got some music to start, and then at this point here, let's say we've got our first phrase. You can clearly see it with this waveform. Then I want to cut it. So to do that, I need to select the cut tool or the razor tool, and the keyboard shortcut, as you can see, is C. Hit C and you'll see that my cursor shows a little razor, and if I go to this point, I can cut it. And then if I hit a V, which is the key next to C, or I select the tool here, I can now take this and move it along. So I can have the music coming, and I want it to fade while he speaks and come back up again, fade, and then the next section, hit the C key again, cut, V key to get my arrow tool and pull across my selection tool, and I can go through the whole thing like that if I want. I can cut, V, pull it along, just get the pacing right. But you need to work out what the pacing is going to do before you put any fades in. You need to make sure that you've got the audio at the right pace to go with the music. So that means you have to listen to them both together. You have to work out how it sounds. And when you know that you've got it roughly how it should work, that's when you need to start talking about automation, so that we can automatically use these faders here. In fact, in this particular one, it'll just be this fader in channel 1. This fader to fade up and fade down the music in channel 1 so that we can clearly hear the audio. So how do we do that? Well, if I play the music along, I can actually physically pull this down and pull it up, but it's not going to remember that for when it comes to outputting the whole thing. Because at the moment, you'll see at this drop down under where we've named our channel music, it says read. And if I click and have a little look, you can see I've got a whole series of different modes. Now, what are these modes? Well, they're ways for Premiere Pro to know what we've done and to remember it and repeat it and give us a few options. Now, obviously, there's off. We're not going to look at that one. Read is just going to read what has already been done. Now, at the moment, we haven't done anything in our channel, so it's just going to read the level at 0 all the way along, and that's what it'll play. So read is the default that we want to end up going back to when we finished. So read is simply going to look at the keyframes we have created by changing this slider. The dangerous one is actually the one at the bottom, and this is the one that we use quite a bit, is write. If I click on write, no matter what I do from the minute I push play, Premiere Pro is going to remember it and write over whatever was there beforehand. Now, if you leave it in write mode accidentally and just hit the spacebar, because you do not need to hit record and play for this, this will be remembered as soon as you hit the spacebar. So as soon as you hit the spacebar, it starts recording it. If you've accidentally somehow left it in write, it'll write over what's already there. So Adobe have said, well, this is a real danger. People are accidentally going to write over what they do, so we'll give them a little fail-safe. What we'll say is, as soon as write has finished, we're going to change it to a different automation mode that doesn't instantly start as soon as they hit the spacebar. And that option is found up here in the panel menu. See these lines in this down arrow? This is the panel menu for any individual panel. You'll see that they've all got panel menus. So the panel at the front, you get to the menu by clicking here. Click there, and you'll see that right at the bottom it says here, switch to touch after write. Now I'll explain what touch is a bit later on, but what they are saying is, as soon as you hit the space bar to stop playing back, rather than continue with the option to write, which is dangerous because it changes everything from the word go, it goes to a different mode which won't change anything until you start to make changes. So, the danger of write is this. If I create a whole bunch of animation here and then leave it at zero and then go back to have a listen and I hit play, just hitting my space bar, and I'm still in write, it'll just record whatever level I was last at all the way over my careful amount of animation. So let's do a little bit of animation anyway, just to show how it works. So I'm holding the fader, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to fade down quietly when it comes to the actual words, and then I'm going to go back up again afterwards and down again, and you'll get a feel for what it's like. So I'm going to hit the space bar to start play. Instantly, Premiere Pro is going to be creating keyframes. Play.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer, he expected to lose his hair. He even expected to lose some weight. But he never expected.
Okay, so the keyframes have been created. I can't see them. But notice where I have left right. If this was still at right and I went back to the beginning and hit play, everything would be recorded at this volume, which is minus 14.2 dB. But notice it has gone to touch. It has changed its mode because of this particular switch here. But it is certainly a way of stopping us writing over what we've done. Okay, so how do I see these keyframes? Well, to see the keyframes, you need to click on this little show keyframe icon. Click, and you have some options. Now, it says show clip keyframes, and you'd have thought you'd see them, but please bear in mind that this is not a clip, this is a track automation. So we are automating the single track, which could include multiple clips. Okay, so on audio one, I have got one particular piece of music, but I could have five bits of music that go all the way through the track. This is a track change, not a clip change. So actually I need to show the track keyframes. Click on that, and you'll suddenly see a whole series of keyframes. And the keyframes have been created as I have changed and moved the fader. So where no fader moves, there's no keyframes, but as soon as I move the fader, keyframes. Okay, and now if I play that back, you'll hear what it's like. Notice that I'm in touch. Because I'm in touch, it's safe. If I was in write, it would write over at zero at the moment. So let's leave it in touch for now and just play and you'll hear what it's like.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer, he expected to lose his hair. He even expected to lose some weight. But he never expected to lose.
Okay, so that's how it would work for using write. Now, my preference is actually not to use write. I actually prefer to use touch. Now, firstly, I need to undo all that's been done here. And to undo this, I'm simply going to go right back to the beginning, and I'm going to hit write, and I'm just going to hit my space bar until I've got to the end of my animation. I'll just cut this out. Okay, so what I've done is I've simply gone over with write at zero, and it's created two keyframes where I started and where I stopped. If I want, I can grab hold of that keyframe and I can pull it all the way to the end, make sure it's at zero, and let go, if that's what I want to do. Okay, so what's the difference between write, touch, and latch? Okay, well, let's look at touch next. If I click on touch, it's going to give me an option whereby if I pull down this particular slider, rather than having to drag it back up to zero, and as you probably saw in the last clip, occasionally I went over zero and overblew it and made the volume too loud. Instead, I can pull it down and let go, and over a predetermined amount of time, the track volume will return to zero. I don't have to do that, it'll do it automatically. Now, the amount of time that it takes to return to zero is sorted out in your preferences. So if you go to, for a Windows user, it would be Edit Preferences. And for a Mac user, it would be in your Premiere Pro menu, Premiere Pro Preferences. And you go to Audio. You'll see that right at the top, it says Auto Match Time. And at the moment, it says 1 second. So it's saying that it is going to take 1 second from when you let go of this slider to return to 0 dB. Okay, so that's where it's set. If you want it to be quicker, you can change that to 0.5 of a second. If you want it to be slower, you can change it to whatever value you like. But this particular value of returning is actually done in the preferences. So I'm going to click OK. So touch only works from the minute you change something. So if I start to play now, it's not going to add any keyframes in. And in fact, if I had some keyframes in there, it would actually play them as they already are. But as soon as I then move the slider, it starts to create a new bunch of keyframes that overwrites what's written before. And when I let go, it moves up. So very quickly, let's add a couple of keyframes in to demonstrate this. So in write mode, I'm going to add a couple of weird keyframes just to prove the point. And then we'll do it in touch. So at the moment, I'm in write. Hit the space bar. Go straight down.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer.
Okay, a whole bunch of weird keyframes. It's just for demonstration purposes only. But now, because we have that option set where it says switch to touch after write, we now have touch up here. So these keyframes will play while touch is selected, but as soon as I start to want to change things, so I'm going to change things, say, here, then touch will overwrite these keyframes and create new ones. So let's hit the space bar and play and be ready to change things.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer.
Now, I had a real problem there. Did you see? I couldn't actually get hold of the blinking fader. It was going up and down so crazily it was hard to get hold of. So let's try it again, and it's this time I'm actually going to start overwriting immediately so that I can actually get hold of the fader. So, back to the beginning. Spacebar, click grab.
When Andrew was diagnosed with cancer.
Let go and up it goes.
He expected to lose his hair. He even expected to lose some weight. But he never expected to lose his home.
Hit spacebar to stop. And if you can't see the keyframes, they don't automatically refresh, then all you do is simply go back to the show keyframes and click the same thing, show keyframes, and you'll see that a new set have been made. And because I'm using touch to automatically go back up, it's creating fewer keyframes. So that's how you can use touch. Latch is again a similar mode, except latch will not return. Wherever you leave latch, it will stay. So if I pull latch down to minus 18, it will stay in minus 18 until I physically move it back up again. But like touch, it will not write any keyframes until you start moving it. So if you've already done a whole bunch of really good animation with write or with touch beforehand, and you suddenly want to change something right at the end, that's when you might want to use latch, just to pull it down and manually change these bits and pieces. So latch will stay where you latch it. So where you let go, it's going to stay there. Touch will always return to zero as soon as you've let go. Write will remember anything that you do and will start writing from the very moment you start. And read is going to read what you have done. And that is the safe mode to be in. Because once you've done this animation, you don't want to lose it. You want it to stay there because you've got it working properly. You go to read. Now, it doesn't matter what you do with the fader. It's not going to create new keyframes. It's just going to keep on playing back whatever you have done. So those are the different types of automation mode. One other thing to mention. If I go back to preferences, which for a PC is Edit Preferences, and for a Mac is Premiere Pro menu and then preferences, and go back to audio, you've got two little options down here. And these are all to do with, just moving this up, keyframes. If you don't have linear keyframe thinning selected, you will create a keyframe for every frame, which can make Premiere Pro pretty sluggish. But sometimes there are instances when you need to be absolutely precise about things and you would turn off linear keyframe thinning. At the moment it's on and you haven't got too many keyframes created. However, there may be instances when you want to turn it off, but they are very rare. The only other thing you might want to do to create even fewer keyframes, if you don't want to have a very heavily keyframed section, is to click this one down here which says minimum time interval thinning. And basically it's saying only create a keyframe every 20 milliseconds, don't create one every frame, and you can take this all the way up to 2 seconds, I believe. So you can move all the way up very high so that you're only creating keyframes very occasionally, as opposed to creating hundreds and hundreds. I think the default setting of 20 milliseconds is pretty good, so I actually tend to leave that on because it seems to work fairly well to my ear. Well, that's how you can make changes to audio, and you can start to take the advantage of the automation modes of these dynamic faders in Premiere Pro, and you can understand that Read will just read the keyframes that you have already created. Write, the moment you hit the spacebar, will write over whatever was there beforehand and create all kinds of different keyframing. And if you have Write selected, you may actually want to keep it selected, in which case you need to turn off Switch to Touch after Write. And then we have Touch, which will not record anything until you start moving the fader. But as soon as you start moving the fader, it will start to create new keyframes. And when you let go of the fader, over that 1 second interval in the preferences, it will return to zero. And Latch, which will just stay wherever you pull it. Again, it won't start until you start to change the fader. But once you start to change the fader, it will remember what you've done and stay at that value until you physically change it. I hope you found this tutorial useful. My name's Andrew Davis. Thank you for watching.